clear for launch. And with that, shut down your visors, O2 on, and prepare for ignition, 202.
EPP, copy that, and,
Hey, Mr. Rushoff here. So this is our first lesson in our unit on the fundamentals of human geography. Now remember from our introduction to geography lesson that human geography is the study of the human characteristics of the Earth and how spatial relationships define them. And when we talk about human characteristics, what we'll learn is that the human characteristics are best described when we start looking at its culture. And that is the focus of this lesson. So what is culture? Well, culture is the total knowledge, attitudes, and behaviors learned and passed by members of a group. In other words, culture addresses all we know, all what we think, and all of what we do. Within a culture, it includes what we eat, where we sleep, who we worship, how we interact with our family, how we speak, how we organize ourselves and our existence within groups, and how we write, paint, or draw, and so much more. Culture includes everything we are and everything we do. Now, there are some terms we need to know when we talk about culture. The first is society. Now, there's several different definitions for this, but I think the best is that this is the aggregate of people, which means all the people, who are living together in a more or less ordered community. So when we talk about a society, we're talking about a group of people that have come together and they've organized themselves. And they've organized themselves maybe through laws or maybe a family code or a set of rules. Now within a society, there can be ethnic groups. An ethnic group is a group that shares common customs or common heritage. And what is interesting is ethnicity is a cultural construct. It is not biological. In fact, studies of DNA have revealed that there are more differences within people of an ethnic group than there are between different ethnic groups. Ethnicity is cultural. An ethnic group really is a group of people who share the same values and, well, culture. But as we begin learning about cultures different than our own, we need to defend ourselves against something called ethnocentrism. Ethnocentrism is the idea that your group, your own culture, is better than the others. There is probably nothing that has more separated the people of the world and has created as much conflict as ethnocentrism. Now, the problem is, it's so easy to be ethnocentric. Let me give you some examples. What if I told you that some people in South Korea will not write the names of other people in red if they're still alive? Does that sound odd? Okay, then what about the people in Karnataka, India, where Hindus and Muslims will toss babies off of a 30-foot-high balcony into the blankets held by villagers below in order to bring the children good health and good luck? Still on face? Okay, I got one for you. Let's talk about the people of the Yanomami tribe that is in the Amazon rainforest between Venezuela and Brazil. When adults die, they will wrap their body in leaves and let insects basically eat at the flesh. After a month or so, what they will do is they'll gather the bones, they'll grind up the bones, they'll mix it into a banana soup, and everyone in the village will consume it. Now, how easy is it to pass judgment on any of these cultural practices, thinking that maybe your own culture is even better? Pretty easy. But that is ethnocentrism. And this is the reason why the Spaniards judged the Aztecs when they found out that they were sacrificing humans, or the Romans looked down at a group of Jews in Judea who professed of a man who came back from the dead and would celebrate him by drinking and eating his blood in his body of God. So as we continue in this course, I'm going to ask you to be on the guard against ethnocentrism. You don't have to agree with the practices of another culture, but be wary of judging another culture as not being quite as good as your own. Now, there are five things we should know about culture. First of all, it is all-encompassing, it is learned, it's shared, it's dynamic, and it is symbolic. Now, from the definition of culture, we have already touched on that culture is all-encompassing. It is the total knowledge, attitudes, and beliefs of a group. You cannot get away from culture. Culture envelops each and every one of us and touches every aspect of our lives. Everything we are and everything we do is shaped by culture. But we should also understand that culture is learned. But it isn't necessarily that culture is something we learn in school. For example, your first language, whether it was English or Spanish, wasn't learned at school. It was learned from your friends and family around you from the time you're a baby. This process is called enculturation, which is the process of socialization that helps a person learn their culture. So we learn our culture from the time we're babies, but culture is also shared between societies. Let me give you an example. Is this a Korean wedding? Or is this a Korean wedding? Well, they both are. But this one is a traditional wedding with a bride and groom wearing what is known as hanbok. When I lived in Korea, a good friend of mine married a Korean woman, and I participated in his wedding, which was kind of like this. To honor her family, Roy agreed to a traditional Korean wedding, and I had a small part. I got to carry the wedding ducks in and stand next to my friend Roy during the ceremony. Now, the ceremony was in a big park in Busan, which is a city in the southeast portion of the peninsula. So there was Roy, a kid from Iowa, standing there in full hanbok, standing next to his beautiful bride in her hanbok. Now, across the park, I could see another couple getting married. And unlike Roy, who was an American, they were full Korean. However, the groom was in a very elegant tuxedo, and the bride was in a flowing white dress. Both of these were Korean weddings, but the modern wedding that the other couple were celebrating was due to the sharing of the Western culture that had been shared with the Koreans, really starting after about the Korean War. When a society accepts aspects of another culture as their own, this is called acculturation. Acculturation occurs as different societies interact with each other and culture spreads. The spreading of ideas, inventions, and patterns is called diffusion and is part of the movement theme of geography. And the place from which a culture originates and moves from is called a cultural hearth. For example, jazz is a type of music that originated in New Orleans, Louisiana in 1895. Today, jazz, however, is celebrated around the world. In this case, New Orleans is the cultural hearth of jazz. Now, there are many different cultural hearths, and we'll be focusing on four in this course. They are the ancient river civilizations such as Mesopotamia, ancient Egypt, and the Harappan and the Yangtze river civilizations. Each have been cultural hearths not only to their regions of Europe, Asia, and Africa, but to the entire world. Now, as societies have more contact with each other, their cultures come together, and this is called cultural convergence. Now, just as plate convergence is the colliding of tectonic plates, cultural convergence is the colliding of cultures. What we find with cultural convergence is as cultures come together, they become more similar. This is the reason why you can now go to Korea and see a wedding, and it's probably going to be very similar to what you're going to see in the United States. Now, the introduction of the airplane, television, telephone, the internet has increased the rate of convergence around the world and what is known as globalization. Essentially, globalization is cultural convergence on a worldwide scale. And the culture that is becoming more and more dominant is that of the United States. This is largely through American multinational corporations such as McDonald's. This is why you can eat McDonald's in 118 countries in the world today. But just as cultures can come together through cultural convergence, societies can be separated from each other either through distance, physical geography, or from their own choice. When this happens, the cultures of the societies will become more different. We call this cultural divergence. For example, between Spain and France, there is a mountain range called the Pyrenees, which separate their people. On one side of the Pyrenees, people will speak French now. On the other side, people will speak Spanish. Now, distance can also create cultural divergence. The further away two sets of people are, the less interaction there will be. We call this phenomenon distance decay, but it also creates cultural divergence. Now, cultural divergence may also be intentional. Take the Amish, who are a group of people who live in states such as Pennsylvania and Indiana. They've made a choice to live in their own communities. They don't accept modern technology, and they have evolved into a culture that is different than the rest of the United States. This is called intentional cultural divergence. Now, let's quickly review some of the terms we've learned so far. Enculturation is how people or individuals learn their culture. Acculturation is how societies adopt elements of another culture as their own. Diffusion is how cultures spread. Cultural convergence is how cultures come together, become more similar. Cultural divergence is when societies are separated by distance, physical geography, or intentional actions, and the cultures become more different. Then we see that culture is dynamic, and dynamic means it is constantly changing. That's what we find in culture. For example, here are three pictures. Can you identify which picture shows the American culture? Well, actually, they all do, but at different times in our history. And there are two major reasons why culture changes. We've already talked about the first one, which is acculturation. As a society is introduced to different cultures, they will begin to adopt aspects of these cultures. It might be food, language, music, really anything that a society might want to be able to take from one culture and make their own. The other major factor that makes cultures be dynamic and always changing is technology. And what is technology? Well, let's see if you already know the answer. Let's take a look at these three pictures. Which one do you think is technology? And if you answered all three, you're absolutely right. Technology is the application of knowledge for a practical ends. It is mankind's constantly looking to solve problems. And whatever mankind develops to solve these problems is technology. Now, a closely related term is innovation. In fact, innovation is often used interchangeably with the word invention. But innovation is when someone takes an existing technology and solves a different problem with it or uses that technology differently. Now, the process of innovation usually inspires new invention, and the process and the cycle continues. And because this process of identifying problems, developing technology, and then innovation is continuous, so is the change in culture. A great example of technology changing your culture is your cell phone. When I went to high school, we didn't have cell phones. They didn't exist yet. Yet now, cell phones have changed how we communicate with each other, how we're able to gather information, and even how we are able to take pictures. Technology is always changing, so culture is always changing. We also find that culture is symbolic. A symbol is something verbal or nonverbal that stands for something else. Cultures are based upon a shared set of symbols and meanings. In a Christian culture, the cross has a specific meaning, as does the crescent, moon, and star in a Muslim culture. Our flags are designed with symbolic meaning to express the elements of each nation's culture. Many times, a culture's symbols can be natural. The bald eagle has a symbolic meaning to Americans, as does the lion to the English. People express their culture in symbols. Among the most important symbols of a culture is its language. A language is a method of human communication, either spoken or written, consisting of words in a structured or conventional way. There are over 7,000 languages spoken in the world. Each language is a mirror of the culture that uses it. After all, it is through language that you learn your culture. But language not only shapes the culture, it is shaped by that culture. Thus, language changes just as any other aspect of culture will change, subject to cultural convergence and divergence. We can see cultural divergence at work when we look at language families. A language family is a group of languages characterized by their similarities and their evolution. This is pretty much like tracing your family tree to your ancestors. For example, most European languages come from the Indo-European language family. But because people didn't live all in the same place in Europe, this family is split into 6 different groups in Europe, including the Germanic and the Italic languages of Germany and Italy. Now, the English language actually came out of the split of Germanic languages, and Latin came out of Italy. Now, when the Roman Empire began to conquer Europe, the Roman soldiers brought with them the spoken version of Latin. This vulgar Latin would become the base for Italian, French, Spanish, Portuguese, and several other languages, all of which we call Romantic languages, but we don't call them the Romantic languages because they are the language of love, but because they were all derived from the Romans. Even within the same language, there are differences. Take English. Even while we can still understand each other, how we speak English in the United States is different from how it's spoken in England. For example, a metal that many airplanes are made out of is called aluminum in the United States, but aluminium in England. In England, you might use the loo. In America, you use the toilet. In England, when you're going on a trip, you might be putting the luggage in the boot of your car. In the States, you're going to put your suitcase in the trunk. The last letter of the alphabet is still this one. And while we call this letter Z, in England, they call it the letter Z. This is an example of a dialect. Now, a dialect is a change in speech patterns of the same language related to class, religion, or cultural changes, and they occur in every language. In fact, dialects can occur within a dialect itself. Even within the American language, there is dialects. In Texas, if you're calling to a group of people, you might say y'all. However, since I grew up in Kansas, I'll likely say you guys. If you wanted a carbonated drink with sugar in Texas, you might call for a soda or a Coke. As a kid in Kansas, I asked for a pop. Now, you might call the top part of a house a roof in Texas. I grew up pronouncing it a roof. These are all examples of dialects called by cultural divergence as people move away from each other. Now, with so many languages in the world and each language having its own dialect, you can imagine the difficulties as you start to travel and trade around the world. This is where something called a lingua franca comes in. A lingua franca is a language that is adopted as the common language to be used between people who have different native languages. English is a perfect lingua franca. If you're an airline pilot,
good heading and descend at pilot's discretion, maintain 6,000.
Our current heading.
Regardless of where you're from, when you call either the airport control tower or you're talking to another airplane, you're going to speak English. That way, anyone involved in airline travel will be able to understand you. This is because the international community has decided upon English to be the lingua franca of international air travel. All right, so you now should understand what culture is. We'll continue to be looking at human geography in further lessons, but until then, keep on learning.